Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and special thanks to people behind the scene for making this kind of conversation possible, and to all of you who are here sharing your valuable experiences with us. It's a great opportunity. I would like to start with this title, Building Knowledge, Building Community, as an attempt to answer my own questions about urbanization, that where I recognize that today we need to develop a new knowledge about how we build our cities, even materially, because the current way of building creates more problems than it solves. And this knowledge was already known around 27 years ago to me when I graduated. And right from the beginning, I have been asking those questions and attempting to solve them. And I think the hint of the answer I can give today for myself is in that direction, that not only the knowledge is important, but taking the time, even though it looks like we really have a sense of urgency with the rate at which things are advancing and overwhelming us, we need to take the time. There are no shortcuts. We need to build this new knowledge and look at every new project as an opportunity to build this knowledge and also to build community. I think that's what the new cities are going to hopefully be about. I want to raise those five questions I have listed for myself and define that as the attempt, like everything we do is taking note that there are no clear answers, and through our action we will respond to the question through action, not through a simple answer. One is this population issue. I grew up in Bombay. I'm telling you about the Indian perspective now. We are 1/6 of the world's population. China is also 1/6. So only between us, we are 1/3 of the planet living there. However, India has only 2.4% of the world's land with this 1/6 of the world's population. So no matter how we have developed Western cities in the past, at that time we did not have this kind of questions, and the Western model of cities cannot work for us. We cannot afford to get our urbanization wrong. All those cities that are now urbanizing have this kind of issues. We have huge numbers of people moving into cities, infrastructure bursting at the seams. And on the other hand, the people who are moving from rural areas to urban areas and will continue to do so in the future will not change their mindset merely by moving into an apartment. These are rural, the bulk of the population in India are rural in the mindset. It's not going to change overnight. And the definition of what of developing the civic sense to live together and do things and re-establishing a new kind of community that works in urban areas is going to be a challenge. Migration is increasingly going to be everybody's state, and we do not, this is the second question, how are we going to root ourselves to a place that we got uprooted from, including identity issues. The third question that I have raised is, what are we going to do about globalization's consequence in how it raises the demand for a higher consumption lifestyle? You see the ground realities everywhere in India, pigs, cows, and the rural context, but all these kind of glass towers that people have seen in Dubai, Singapore, and places. When I mention these countries, where I mean to say where you could not link the building to the place anymore. It comes along with centrally air-conditioned buildings and certain materials and industrial and standard products that actually come at a very high environmental, social, and economic price. So these are the imbalances and promises that, those same images of city are being actually perpetuated in places. And this is a really big question for me. Already without this globalized demand, we're not meeting, we don't have enough resources to meet the demand. So now we have a higher standard defined. Social segregation and urban poverty, not the same as poverty, I mean urban poverty, because people have more jobs where they work more than 8 or 10 hours, but they cannot include housing in that economy. So that this is a very big growing problem. The fact that the urban form has this duality, it's one of the biggest questions for us. How are we going to make our urban developments actually affordable to the bulk of the population, not only to the elite? And finally, the question of materiality of how we build cities and how industrialized and over-standardized materials are becoming the vernacular, and what are the implications of those decisions which appear to be micro decisions, but each building chooses that, but what does the whole picture add up to? So in order to attempt to answer those kind of questions, which, as I said, were already in the air at the time I graduated. So therefore, right from the beginning, I decided to dedicate my practice to the process of building the new knowledge which I will require to be able to not at least add to the problem. And I will share with you now just a couple of strategies. Obviously, there are no answers. It would be too ambitious to even attempt. But I think already the recognition of the danger and the problem of doing things in the habitual way, it's already a big step. And the process is to go on. The process has been to not focus on the fruits and the projects, but to really accept that the process involves digging deep into the roots and discussing those kind of deep investigations which have led to a certain kind of difference in the architectural practice. Or the battle that I mention here is actually inside us, and the battle is that we do not have the knowledge and the clarity how to take the next steps. So it's important to recognize that the projects that we create are only the manifestation of the knowledge we have or don't have at this moment to cope with the problem that faces us. I feel that the biggest issue is the disconnection of place. I have always looked at every project starting with unearthing the roots that root human life to that place wherever it is we are building, however globalized it may appear. Once we identify the life and also look at livelihoods that are intertwined with how we have made our cities or even villages in the past. I think this is very important because all the areas in the world where urbanization is taking place currently are in those places that were not so industrialized as the developed countries. And they have their own, they've got huge interlinkages between material, building material manufacture, the territory, the economy, and social life, and etc. So I give you this example. This is in India, but it could be in Africa, it could be anywhere, where if you just start looking at how the bricks, that the basic building unit, that is how it's made everywhere in the world, it tells a story about the larger socio-economic context. In most of these countries, bricks are made not of the highest quality in those very big quarries where, like we see in the industrial bricks that you find in Europe. They are made by people at a time when the agricultural cycle allows them to work with the clay that has collected after the monsoon, etc. When they plant tree, they plant, this is casuarina wood, in order to use as scaffolding, etc. But when they have to thin those forests where they've planted, they take away the trees that need to be chopped and cleared, and that goes into cooking those building materials. So making of a material, or just choosing a material from a building catalog, which is happening now in all over those kind of countries by often Western architects or Western education influenced architecture schools in these countries, are not thinking about all this anymore and not thinking about the interconnections that allowed a harmonious, sustainable lifestyle. These are, for instance, lime communities who procure and process lime, and that's all they do in their lives. Or there are other people who quarry stone and they manage to somehow that's what is available in the place. Their livelihoods and their skills are developed around that. So when I go to places, I try very hard to dig into the roots and find those things out. And even if we produce contemporary architecture, we try to critically examine the building materials culture in the place and include it. And instead of urbanization taking away their jobs, we try to, in fact, provide a further livelihood to them. So here, for instance, are potters' communities who are unable to sell the pots that they have been making for centuries. Nobody wants to cook in those earth pots anymore. They use metal. So all these kind of economies of these people are threatened and their livelihood. So we started giving them building materials to manufacture that are even more superior, I would say, to the conventional building materials in the sense that these are insulating, they are made with local material, they are not cooked with coal in kilns, they are made with coconut shells and so on. So there is a very important need to negotiate between high tech and low tech to see what is appropriate for a particular socio-economic condition, context, and to look at how much handmade and how much machine made to go for. And these are the things that have to be designed actually and negotiated. So here are some examples of how roofs can be constructed differently with giving the same community who lived in a rural context an opportunity to be part of the building of urban solutions near them. And these solutions that are now built require far less steel, far less high energy materials, employ local labor, enrich them, keep the money in the local economy, produce the contemporary spaces that are required that perform environmentally much more efficiently than the contemporary buildings, but they continue to be as, if not more, contemporary in the void and the design of the spaces. So I think it is very important now to look at how materiality of our cities will be. We need to create room for experimentations, even if it is sometimes radical. For example, these are some houses we have produced where it's an orphanage, in fact, where we are testing the technology of firing large-scale mud houses in situ. Fire is a cement. We don't need to bring cement from outside. We treat those places as kilns, the houses, and inside them we produce bricks, because bricks, actually, when you produce them in factories, they lose about 40% of the energy created into the kiln walls again and again. And how can we tap this? And how can the people who make these local bricks all over the world, in fact, be able to at least not be homeless themselves? And just the use only materials from the place, and then the rest is their own labor. We are looking at approaches including participation, where we believe that if we don't allow people to participate in the making of their own houses, and if we keep on perpetuating the debt economy when it comes to housing, and we look at houses as a commodity rather than a home in which to spend our lives and get on with our activities, when you see the birds and bees building their homes in few days and getting on with their lives, you feel envious, because now human beings who are supposed to be more clever than that are not able. They become like slaves and of wage slaves, and we are all caught up in all those economic debts just because when we are about to die, we are going to have a house rather than finish the house and move on. So people say, no, we are now very urban. Our laws don't allow us to participate. No, we have had the Selbsthilfe program even in Berlin, you know, where people were, it's all about policies and so on. And it's the vision that we have. If we don't allow people to give the few hours that they are now dedicating to Facebook and whatnot, there's always some time we can make available and put it into the projects, and we need to design for that. And it is possible, even in urban areas. So these are some houses. This was an example of an urban eco-community where people were involved in making not only their homes, but also building communities. When you work together, you build a relationship. That is also important. And then talking about looking at materials anew, I think one of the important things to do is to really research materials deeply and not to make any frivolous choices without thinking about consequences. So we have dedicated lots of time understanding all kinds of materials, developing new material that use significantly less resources. They are much thinner. maybe use 20% of materials that we built, we use normally for the same square meters. So we have to also include the thinking about how urban waste can be absorbed. Not that we want to encourage more urban waste to happen, but we would like to see that at least building can absorb a lot of the urban waste. Here we are working with recycled wine bottles or building masonry with bottles or whatever we find, like bicycle wheels. All the windows had cost 100 rupees in this case. I mean, there is always something. You can kill two birds with one stone. On one hand, you reduce the waste. On the other hand, you look at the waste as a, like, in, through the vulture's point of view, and you try to, like a scavenger, take what you get and actually technologically figure out where you can actually use it. Thinking with the hands is also very important. This digital world is making us disconnect totally. And sometimes, if you don't engage with your own hands into the solution, we are actually not on the real ground like yours. Just we lose the contact to the earth. And in academia, everywhere, we need to introduce this kind of contact. Some of these solutions, these are books that would have got pulped in Australia or burnt like they do in Spain. Every country has its own shocking ways of disposing huge amounts of books. Actually, books are a very big source of urban waste. We have been playfully looking at what we can do with all these kind of things. But if you look at the old ways of designing only in the drawing board, we are not going to stumble upon these solutions. We have to bring those materials and play with them. That's the only way that can come out. This is one investigation we did with what to do with books. Now I've put this book, this project from Catalonia, where there's so much turbulence going on with even the banks moving out. This is their book, Caixa. We were asked to do a pavilion called Library of Lost Books, for demonstrating the cause and the need for liberty, etc. And I had said, knowledge makes you free. Let's work with that. You know, let's look for inner freedom through expanding the consciousness. And like in the Spanish household ways of packing their food, ham and olives, etc., in simple machines that take out the air, we used that same method to extend the life of books and of knowledge, where people have a short attention span. And we try to create canopies out of this material, because this Filmoteca actually has a library on top, and they supplied us all the waste books that they would have had to dispose normally. And we created a public space in the square where, in fact, Library of Lost Books means that there are no books. You can read, you can sit under the shade of books and remember how it used to be, and you can keep looking at your gadgets. Anyway, at least they are reading still. But anyway, these are what is possible to do with urban fabric, like, whether the waste is books or whether it is rests from jeans. You know, India supplies jeans along with China to the whole world, and those rest of those pieces remain as a huge environmental problem. We are trying to spend all these kind of wastes and divert them into some productive solutions. So these are multi-pronged approaches where we, as a professor, I also try to create academic collaborations for students to not remain excluded from real issues, but have them confront reality so that they can graduate and help the world to become better. They need to not be isolated from other disciplines. They need to work with all interdisciplinary, intercultural situations. This is a student from Bangladesh for the first time using a sewing machine, only because it was put in the studio. So these are the type of things we need to do so that people can explore things firsthand. And the knowledge that we need today has to be experiential. Here is also a similar example of recycling Tetra Pak by refilling them. It's a very difficult thing to dispose. But once you wash it and fill it back with water or sand, like we did in Mexico, you can reuse them as bricks. And this kind of projects involve literally no money, because you've just taken away the garbage. You've got many hands to work because there are students doing it. And those students are actually learning a lot each day. And it's part of the academic process. Finally, I would like to say that I now believe not only in choosing the right materials carefully, judiciously, but relying on engineering to use significantly less quantities. We are working with ferro cement and looking at very, very thin cement elements for durability, but 2.5 centimeters, looking at origami patterns to be able to stiffen them so that we can cast these kind of shells on paper instead of wood, on recycled carton. And then, you know, use, just look at how little steel this is. This is a prototype for a housing project, and it takes 4 days to build this. So it's for a disaster relief, you can just go with your flattened paper, open it out, pour the concrete, and you can actually move the whole element as well. This is a low-cost toilet, which can be put up in 1 day. Yeah, I will just show a quick prefab version of a house made in collaboration in the university with students and craftsmen who came from India. These are houses that can be put up in 3 or 4 days. And they are contemporary. They use really, really minimal materials, but they are durable. I'm ending with this image of Auroville, an alternative city grounded exactly 50 years ago in South India, where I was living after I left Bombay for the last 25 years. I'm involved with that place. All the questions that we are talking about here, Auroville was planned to be a laboratory, a living laboratory for an alternative city, where it's all about the new mobility and responding to all these complex problems, because city is seen as a solution to work out these problems, as an opportunity where these problems can be addressed and resolved. I leave this slide. We are applying all the things I showed you on a big scale of 8,000 people habitat and integrally solving all these complex problems with very, very new kind of thinking. Thank you.